Which one do I press to make it go? Is it the right one? The right clicker? Okay, thank you. Darragh Worledge, 495 Hillcrest Avenue in Nanaimo. I would like to stress that I consider bylaws to address the problem of cat regulation to perhaps not be the best route to go. I believe that putting a lot of bylaws through on this issue can have more problems than it will actually help. For example, if you put a bylaw through to say that everyone in the city had to have their cat spayed or neutered at 6 months of age, you would be enabling a black market in kittens. Where are you going to get your kittens? This encourages other social problems. So I'm going to try and address this from a completely different viewpoint. You'll have to bear with me on this. Cat companions, faces of love. Who is that old woman? And how dare she have a pet? After all, it's expensive to own a pet. She clearly can't afford it. That's just plain irresponsible. And that kitten, did it come from an approved breeder? We need to see the paperwork, you know, shots and whatnot. It's disgusting to let just any old person breed their pet, where they might get carried away. It's just not responsible. And that lady with the orange cat, have you checked her bank account? Just how suitable is she as a pet owner? Love isn't enough, you know. A homeless guy with a pet cat? Well, he can't even take care of himself, let alone that poor kitten. Maybe it's a good thing that Nanaimo is considering cat regulation bylaws. I mean, it's likely best that all these cats be rounded up and dumped off at the pound. They can take care of them. We really don't want the poor kitties to suffer, so we'll simply humanely kill them all, and the problem is solved. In adopting a bylaw amendment which promotes voluntary compliance among cat owners and meets the requirements of council, staff anticipates an added cost of between $10,000 and $20,000 in the initial year, which would be funded through general revenue. This is primarily for the purchase of new holding cages, euthanasia fees, landfill fees, and extra costs for food and cleaning. So what if pet owners will be heartbroken? If they can't afford the bills, fines and fees, well then, they shouldn't own a pet. It's irresponsible and they can just deal with their pain and grief. And what's this? Those parents let that cat near their baby? Why, at the very least, there's germs to consider. Such irresponsible people shouldn't have a cat. Or a baby either, come to think of it. But they say regulating cats is very pricey. If council wishes to implement bylaw changes to license and regulate cats, staff estimates the initial costs will be between $100,000 to $150,000 per year. It is proposed that the city establish an education program and associated best practices pertaining to cats, placing the onus on the cat owner to have their cat spayed and neutered. Onus on the cat owners, But those guys are all poor. How can they possibly afford to care for a cat? I mean, look at this guy, for crying out loud. He's a street musician. Another homeless person. I wonder if he used the SNP program to get his cat neutered. Cat companions help people, including the most vulnerable. They say that owning a cat actually helps people. That caring for a pet gives companionship and a sense of purpose. That it helps vulnerable people in our community. That finding a way to help people keep their pets is important. That love and caring are enough. Similarly, a study of homeless women living in shelters in six Canadian cities found that nearly half of participants cited attachment as the primary reason for owning a pet. Participants also identified the unconditional acceptance due to the non-judgmental nature of pets and a source of comfort as other important reasons to own a pet. Of these women, 82% reported feeling lost after having to surrender their pets in order to stay in shelters. Studies with homeless youth also show the significance of love and companionship. These were common themes for participants, with 84.5% reporting, "My pet keeps me company," and 79.3% with "My pet gives me someone to love." In her thesis, Michelle Lim found a universally high level of pet attachment among homeless youth. She also found that youth with pets reported lower rates of depression. So rather than threatening fines and fees and handing out Valium and Xanax, instead we should consider encouraging pet owners to keep their companion animals. Rather than punitive fines and fees, financial aid programs for low-income pet owners recognize the substantial social and health benefits offered by companion animals. Maybe it's not irresponsible to care for a cat, even if you're a kid, even if you're poor, even if it's just a worthless alley cat, even if you're homeless. In fact, organizations throughout North America know just how important pet companions are for people. They're looking for ways to help people keep their beloved animal friends. Here's a list. I'm not going to go through it all, and these are primarily probably organizations in the United States, but they are throughout North America, the Big Hearts Fund, Magic Bullet Fund, Paws for a Cure, Pets for the Homeless, and it goes on and on. This is a case study, Elmo. Elmo had stones blocking his urinary tract. He could not pass urine, and when he did, it was very little and bloody. Toxins were quickly building up in his system, and he was in excruciating pain and getting weak. We could not afford treatment since we were on disability. His vet bill was $1,020. The Farley Foundation covered $1,000 of it. Without the Farley Fund, he would be dead right now. Because of the Farley Foundation, Elmo was literally snatched from the jaws of death. Because of the Farley Foundation, he now has a second chance at life and is snoring very loudly beside me. What an adorable sound. The Farley Foundation is amazing. Thank you from the bottom of Elmo's, myself, and my family's hearts. Here's another great idea. Tales of Help. This is a charity golf tournament dedicated to keeping pets at home by providing assistance to financially challenged pet owners. Help people to be healthier and stronger through the sharing with and caring of their feline friends. Every kitten offers an invaluable gift. Every person, young or old, financially well off or not so much, deserves to have their life enriched by this precious connection with their special animal companion. Rather than promoting an adversarial relationship with cat owners using punitive bylaws, instead, try and find ways to help people and their pets receive the care they might need. Don't create enemies and hardship. Rather promote goodwill and a healthier society for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Beswick.
Just a comment. Thank you for taking me to the brink of cruelty and breaking my heart and taking me back to breaking my heart in a really good way. So I appreciate you for doing that and the time and energy and effort that you must have taken to put this together. And I think you captured it when, how do we help and not be adversarial and make this work for everybody in the community. Thank you.
I know all about grief. I've unfortunately lost my very precious cat companion to inoperable cancer. So I wanted to really emphasize this is about people, their connection with their pets. Also, pets are very expensive. That shouldn't be the definitive thing that stops a person from having a pet, whether it's a cat or a dog. And when you increase that difficulty by punitive fines and fees, $450, $300, you're increasing hardship in people's lives. This is my big point here. When I try to show how other communities throughout North America have recognized that, and they are doing something to help people providing free food. This includes people who have homeless people who have pets. I'd like to see the direction shift more to helping people keep their pets rather than this adversarial bylaw, you're bad because you're not, you're in contravenience of the bylaw. So I wanted to give a completely different perspective to the situation because, as you can see, cats and dogs provide a very, very important, very crucial health benefit to people. With the statistics on homeless use, again, what do you want to give them, Valium, or do you want to let them have a pet cat? Do you want to allow them to be in a situation where they can access support so that they can have a pet cat? Personally, I think having a pet cat would be much healthier than having a drug problem.
You've come support.
Well, I think you've just given me another option to eliminate homelessness. Just give them all cats and we don't have to worry about housing them.
Generalizing. But hey, if it worked, hey, yeah. I would think that would be kind of cool.
I'm just kidding. The question with regards to the study on homeless youth, was that strictly with regards to cats or did it include dogs?
No, you're quite right on that. It was both cats and dogs. Because this particular part of the bylaw is addressing cats, I focused on cats. Yep. But that was pets, period.
Yep.
Yes, very, very, very important for people's emotional health.
Okay, so being fair, and I'm all about fairness, which is what gets me in trouble sometimes. Could you see us actually eliminating some of the stuff we have around dogs? Yeah.
One point that I did want to emphasize is nobody's suggesting a blanket spay neuter for dogs.
Yeah.
It just cats. That gets again back to this enabling a black market in pet kittens. You're already seeing dramatic increases in the price of pet kittens in Vancouver, say, for example. And many cat advocacy groups have noted that over $100 for just an average kitten is not uncommon. So again, I'm personally not at all sure that putting through a bylaw is the answer. Absolutely, I'm behind any kind of public education type of a situation or anything else that you very intelligent people can come up with, as long as it's supportive of people as opposed to being punitive. No adversarial relationships. I really feel that is a mistake. That's my opinion.
Actually, people will hate me for this one because actually you've given me an idea that maybe we can institute a spay-neuter program for dogs. I'm going to get in a lot of trouble over this one. I do like cats, but I literally watched this one cat decimate the bird population in my hedges, just literally decimated over one season. He would come in at nighttime and just, he would get them while they were, whatever birds were sleeping. It was phenomenal, actually, how quickly this one cat did that. And I never did find out where the cat lived, and it was amazing the cat didn't get hit crossing Needham Street. I used to own 8 cats when I was younger. My brother back there came to visit me one time, and it was actually, had to give up the bed because the cats would sleep there. Whatever happened to some of those cats, I don't know. I really don't know, and I think that's sad for the cats. So,
anyhow, the statistics are that cats are not the number one killer of birds. I appreciate what you're saying, and like any animals, there's the occasional one that can be a problem, but the statistics are the number one killer of birds is habitat destruction, and number two is various forms of hawks. If you think that cat had it good, hey, he's on the ground. Birds can fly away. Hawks, phew, they're 80% of a hawk's diet is songbirds. So it gets kind of off the topic again. We're discussing, well, anyhow.
I see no further questions, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you.